Washington to Moscow, from New York to Paris, from Rome to Jerusalem, around the world, the prophecies of the Bible are being fulfilled. J.R. Church, author and lecturer, is standing by with today's analysis of Bible prophecy. History has reached an impasse. The world is soon to see the return of Jesus Christ. And now, here is J.R. Church with today's prophecy in the news.
Our thoughts and hearts are turned toward Calvary during these days, and we are reminded of the great price that Jesus paid for our salvation. Without the first coming of Christ, the second coming would not be possible. For in the Old Testament, the prophets wrote concerning the suffering and the glory of the Messiah. There must be both written into the histories of men. When he came the first time, he came as the Lamb of God, the sacrifice to take away the sins of the world. When he comes the second time, he will come as the Lion of the tribe of Judah to bring judgment upon wicked men. When he came the first time, he hung upon a cross. When he comes the second time, he shall sit upon a throne. When he came the first time, he wore a crown of thorns. But when he comes the second time, he will wear a royal diadem. When he came the first time, he made himself of no reputation. When he comes the second time, he will be proclaimed King of Kings and Lord of Lords. When he came the first time, he was born in a borrowed stable, toured the Lake of Galilee in a borrowed boat, and was buried in a borrowed grave. But when he comes the second time, he will own all things, for he shall inherit the earth. When he came the first time, Jesus stood before Pilate. When he comes the second time, Pilate shall stand before him. When he came the first time, the Sanhedrin judged him. But when he comes the second time, he shall judge them. When Jesus came the first time, he made his triumphal entry into Jerusalem on the back of a donkey. When he comes the second time, he shall make his triumphal entry on the back of a white horse. He came the first time to make peace. He shall come the second time to make war. When he came the first time, he offered mercy. When he comes the second time, there shall be no mercy. I would like to take you to Calvary today and give you the history behind that awesome place. The hill of Golgotha has a long and colorful history. Some of its history you can find within the pages of the Bible, and some of its history comes from extra-biblical sources. Primarily, the written histories of the Jewish people. The hill of Calvary was called Golgotha, but its more exact name would be Gol Gullet. And according to Jewish literature, Gol Gullet was the place where Adam and Eve were buried. At the foot of this mountain, there is a cave, believed to be the burial site of Adam and Eve. And it is said that Noah retrieved the bones of Adam and Eve and took them aboard the ark for preservation during the flood. The cave of Gol Gullet was also said to be the home of Shem, the son of Noah, and father of the Semites, or the Semitic peoples. It is believed that Shem lived in the cave located at the foot of Calvary. And Jewish literature tells us that Abraham lived in the cave of Gol Gullet in the home of Shem, and there received his education. Yes, according to the Bible, Shem lived to be 600 years old. He was 98 years old when he and his wife embarked from the ark after the flood. And he was 390 years old when Abraham was born. According to Jewish literature, Shem, at the age of 527, attended the funeral of Sarah, Abraham's wife, when she was buried in the cave of Machpelah at Hebron, located just 12 miles south of the cave of Gol Gullet. It is also believed in Jewish history that Isaac received his education from the aged Shem in the cave of Gol Gullet. When Isaac was 60 years of age, he had two sons, Jacob and Esau. They, too, are believed to have received their education in the cave of Gol Gullet under the tutorship of the aged Shem, son of Noah. For you see, Shem died when Jacob and Esau were 40 years old. There is another bit of history about this mountain called Calvary that is quite interesting. In the days of the building of Solomon's temple, the Bible says Solomon sent 80,000 men into the mountain to hew the stones for the building of the temple. Solomon's quarries are located at the foot of the northern wall of Old Jerusalem, just 300 yards south of Calvary. During those days, 1,000 years B.C., the hill of Calvary was part of Mount Moriah. In fact, the valley between Calvary and the northern wall of Old Jerusalem did not exist until the days of the Maccabees. And so, Golgotha may have had a natural bridge above the quarries of Solomon for the transporting of the huge stones from the quarry to the building site on Mount Moriah, where today stands the Mosque of Omar. The men in charge of the quarry would take the stones up the western slopes of Calvary, transport them across the hill, the top of the hill, and over to the building site. However, one day, according to Jewish literature, an odd-shaped stone was sent from the quarry to the building site by way of the natural bridge of Gulgullet. The odd-shaped stone did not seem to fit anything in the plans for the building of the temple, and so it was returned by the builders to the quarry, again by way of the hill of Gulgullet. Well, the men in the quarry, according to their plans, had fashioned the stone properly, and so they sent the stone back to the building site, again across the top of Calvary. The builders of Solomon's temple were frustrated. They could find no need for such a stone in their plans, and so a hassle ensued. Finally, in anger, the builders of the temple brought the odd-shaped stone to the crest of the hill and pushed it over to the valley below. Little did they know that that stone was destined to be the cornerstone of the temple. That is why, in later years, when Peter stood condemned before the Sanhedrin court, he said in Acts chapter 4, verse 11, "This is the stone which was set at naught of you builders, which is become the head of the corner." Yes, above the very spot where the cornerstone of the temple was rejected in the days of Solomon, 1,000 years later, Jesus Christ, our chief cornerstone, was again rejected and nailed to a cross. There is another exciting bit of history about this hill called Calvary. Have you noticed a large dugout area on the side of the hill that appears to be somewhat of a cave? This is called Jeremiah's Grotto. It once was a prison, but erosion over the years has eaten away the side of the hill so that one side of the dungeon has fallen away, exposing the cave. But in the days of Jeremiah, this was a hewn-out dungeon. There is a hole in the ceiling of the cave where the prisoners would be let down into the dungeon. Now, do you remember in the days of Jeremiah, Zedekiah the king became angry at the weeping prophet because Jeremiah preached what the king did not want to hear. Jeremiah tried to tell Zedekiah that he should not rebel against the king of Babylon. But the hard-headed Zedekiah thought he could get away with it. Zedekiah finally became so angry at Jeremiah that he had him arrested and thrown into a miry pit. Jeremiah chapter 38, verse 6 records the event. "Then took they Jeremiah and cast him into the dungeon of Malchiah, the son of Hamalek, that was in the court of the prison, and they let down Jeremiah with cords. And in the dungeon there was no water but mire. So Jeremiah sunk down into the mire." Later, the king repented and commanded Ebed-Melech, the Ethiopian, to take 30 men and rescue Jeremiah out of the dungeon. Verse 11 reads, "So Ebed-Melech took the men with him and went into the house of the king, unto the treasury, and took hence old cast clouts and old rotten rags, and let them down by cords into the dungeon to Jeremiah. And Ebed-Melech the Ethiopian said unto Jeremiah, Now put these old cast clouts and rotten rags under thine armholes, under the cords. And Jeremiah did so. So they drew up Jeremiah with cords. According to Jewish literature, this cave was once the miry dungeon that became a prison for Jeremiah the prophet. Ebed-Melech let the cords down through the hole in the roof of the dungeon and rescued Jeremiah. Yes, the old hill has a long and colorful history, doesn't it? Now bear in mind that this hill called Calvary and Golgullet was once a part of the mountain ridge called Moriah, and it was on Mount Moriah that Abraham brought his son Isaac to offer him in sacrifice. Perhaps you recall that as Isaac and his father made their way up the mountain, Isaac inquired of his father, "Where is the lamb for a burnt offering?" The answer is found in Genesis chapter 23 and verse 8. And Abraham said, "My son, God will provide himself a lamb for a burnt offering." 2,000 years later, God did provide himself for a sacrifice, and he died on the same mountain. In the year 1885, General Charles Gordon was studying one day inside a building located atop the northern wall, just above Solomon's Quarry, and just above the cliff created when the mountain was cut during the days of the Maccabees. He looked out of the window and saw the hill that lay 300 feet to the north. Suddenly, the eroded cave-like areas in the side of the hill appeared to him to be as the place of a skull, and he exclaimed, "Surely, this must be Calvary, the place of crucifixion." Since then, the hill has become known as Gordon's Calvary. On the west end of the southern side of the cliff called Calvary, there is a tomb believed to be the sepulcher of the Savior. It lays in a beautiful garden area believed to have belonged to Joseph of Arimathea. In this area, along with the tomb, there is a wine press once used in the crushing of the grapes. It lays about 50 feet in front of the tomb. And we are reminded from the pages of the Bible that Jesus was to tread the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God alone. Oh yes, I know that that is a prophecy ultimately to be fulfilled at the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. But when Jesus died, he suffered alone. He suffered the wrath of an infinite hell in a finite period of time. Did he not also then walk the winepress alone? And the blood which flowed was his own. He's coming back one day to bring the judgment of God upon those who have refused the shedding of his blood as a sacrificial atonement for their sins. At that time, the prophecy of the winepress will have its ultimate fulfillment. Beneath this area around the garden tomb, there is a water cistern, which seems to indicate that in this immediate area there was once a beautiful and expensive palace, the home of Joseph of Arimathea. For you see, the Bible says that Joseph was a wealthy man, and there are some historians who believe that he was the wealthiest man in the world at that time. Perhaps he owned all of the area along the southern slope of Calvary, or Golgullet. Perhaps, too, the cave of Golgullet was in his possession. Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus tenderly took the body of Jesus from the Roman cross. The sun was setting low in the western horizon, and they had little time to prepare his body for burial. So very quickly they brought his body from the crest of Calvary to Joseph's own new tomb. There they very hastily covered his body in a linen shroud and laid it in the tomb. There was no time to prepare his body properly for burial. It is believed that they laid the cakes of spikenard around his body and covered it with a linen shroud. if the Shroud of Turin is the actual burial cloth of Christ, and if the image upon the Shroud be that of the Savior, then I want you to notice something Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus may have done which is not recorded in the Scripture. Impressed upon the Shroud of Turin is the image of the face of a crucified man. Notice, please, on the forehead there appears to be a square box and a leather strap across the top of it. There is a striking similarity between the box-like impression on the forehead of the crucified man and the Jewish phylactery, or prayer box, that the Jew wears upon his head. Could it be that even in the haste of the burial, Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus placed the Jewish phylactery upon the forehead of Jesus? Please remember, Jesus was a Jew. Furthermore, Jesus was a rabbi. The scriptural authority for the Jewish phylactery comes from Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 6 through 8. And these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart, and thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children, and shalt talk of them when thou sittest in thine house, and when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. And thou shalt bind them for a sign upon thine head, and they shall be as frontlets between thine eyes. That is why, even today, the Orthodox Jew wears the prayer box upon his hand or head. Notice something else about the image of the face upon the Shroud of Turin. According to the scientific studies made of the Shroud in recent years, the impressions of round circles have been found on the cloth over the eyes. It is possible, then, that metal coins were placed upon the eyelids to keep them closed. That, by the way, has been a common custom down through the centuries. The remarkable Shroud, with its incredible image, has been under the protective care of the Church of St. John the Baptist in Turin, Italy, for the past 400 years. It was brought to the church in the year 1578 by the Duke of Savoy under the sponsorship of the royal family of Italy, the House of Savoy. In celebration of its 400th anniversary at Turin, the Shroud was placed on public display in 1978, from August 27th to October 8th. During those 43 days of public exhibition, some 5 million people came to see the Shroud, and more particular, the incredible image of the crucified man upon it. Having been interested in the Shroud, I took the opportunity to go to Turin to see it for myself. The many who came to the cathedral during the exhibit were allowed a close-up inspection of the Shroud. What is immediately noticeable are two parallel lines running the length of the cloth. These marks were caused by a scorching of the cloth during a fire in 1532. Several small portions of the cloth were destroyed in the fire, and the patches along either side were sewn into the burned areas to give it strength. The vague outline of a crucified man can also be seen on the cloth, between the scorch marks. That image can be seen much clearer through a high-contrast photograph. A black-and-white picture shows the image much better than a color photograph. Advocates of the Shroud say they have sufficient evidence to prove that the image is an actual picture of Jesus Christ. In addition to a rare public exhibition of the Shroud, the Archbishop of Turin, Archbishop Balestrato, gave permission for a team of scientists to examine the Shroud for 7 days. Set aside in the royal palace, next to the cathedral, was a room full of scientific equipment, and it was here that the scientists gathered to subject the Shroud to an exhaustive series of tests. Using X-rays, image enhancement, and other special analysis, the team of international scientists made its study of the Shroud under laboratory conditions. A device was used to X-ray the linen cloth. Its molecular structure and the nature of the image were measured. Another instrument scanned the density of the image. The cloth was also tested for infrared, ultraviolet, gamma rays, and other measurements. Two of the chief science researchers for the Shroud project were from the Air Force Academy in Colorado. Dr. Eric Jumper, who, with his colleague, Dr. John Jackson, have discovered that the image is not only photographic, but three-dimensional in nature. Jackson and Jumper electronically scanned the density and contours of the image on the cloth, and from that information, they were able to construct a cardboard statue of the figure. It's an accurate, life-size reproduction to show what the man wrapped in the cloth must have looked like. They put a photo of the cloth through a process called image enhancement. It's the same technique developed for studying satellite photographs of the surface of Mars and Venus. The results showed contours in the cloth almost exactly as they would have been when draped over a human body. In all these experiments, what puzzles the researchers most is how and why some medieval forger could have put so many provocative details into his work. Details which can only be detected today through the use of sophisticated electronic technology. The most obvious answer to that puzzle is that it is not a forgery at all. An American physicist, Dr. Ray Rogers, studied the Shroud in Turin. Afterwards, he said, "What better way, if you were a deity, of regenerating faith in a skeptical age than to leave evidence 2,000 years ago that could be defined only by the technology available in that skeptical age?" And that evidence seems impressive. One scientific discovery about the Shroud is already known. A Swiss researcher, Dr. Max Frey, was able to examine samples of dust from the Shroud under an electron microscope. He found in the sample grains of plant pollen, which he says comes from vegetation that grows only in Palestine. Dr. Frey's conclusion was that at some time in its past, the cloth had been in the area around Jerusalem. Other pollen samples from the Shroud could have only come from areas in eastern Turkey, suggesting that the cloth had once been in Constantinople. The stunning conclusion of modern technology was that the Shroud leads us to the moment before the resurrection. That part of the Shroud which most excites its advocates is the possibility that it illustrates Jesus' resurrection from the dead. Scientists are working on the assumption that a burst of light burned the image into the cloth at the moment of resurrection. It would have been the intense, blinding explosion of light radiating from the corpse in the Shroud. It's an incredible idea that the cloth could be an actual photograph of Jesus' resurrection. But the test results may support this very theory. What we can conclude about the Shroud of Turin is that it is a remarkable portrait of a Roman-style crucifixion. And if nothing else, it shows us graphically the degree of suffering the Savior must have gone through in his death on the cross. While the Shroud tests are still being evaluated, no conclusive evidence can be given as to whether the image is actually that of Jesus. But there is considerable opinion that the cloth is not only the genuine burial shroud of Christ, but that the image was caused at the moment when Jesus was resurrected from the dead. What to think of all this, and how it affects our belief, will be a personal decision. To see the face in the Shroud may be a highly moving and thought-provoking experience. While for some it may be a matter of skepticism, others have described it as the convicting moment when they committed their lives to Jesus Christ.